I'm calling order this meeting. This is the 26th legislative meeting of the Council of the District of Columbia, and it's our regular monthly meeting for the month of June. I'm Phil Mendelson, Chairman of the Council. Today is Tuesday, June 3rd, 2014. The time is 12:13 in the afternoon. We are in room 500 at the Council Chambers. It's always our practice to start our legislative meetings with a moment of silence. I do want to note the passing last week of Maya Angelou, who is a great figure in American culture and American history. If we could have a moment of silence, please. Will the Secretary please call the roll?
Councilmember Alexander.
Here.
Councilmember Barry. Councilmember Barry. Councilmember Bonds.
Here.
Councilmember Bowser.
Here.
Councilmember Catania. Councilmember Catania. Councilmember Che.
Here.
Councilmember Evans.
Here.
Councilmember Graham.
Here.
Councilmember Grasso.
Here.
Councilmember McDuffie.
Here.
Chairman Mendelson.
Present.
Councilmember Orange.
President.
Councilmember Wells.
Here.
Mr. Chairman, you have a quorum.
Thank you. The first item of business is a presentation of a resolution by Councilmember Alexander, the Thomas Robinson Recognition Resolution of 2014.
Good morning. I would like to introduce, and I'm really honored to do this. Actually, this is a very busy young man. I've been trying to do this for 2 years, so I finally got him back in the District of Columbia. I would like to introduce you to one of Ward 7's own, Mr. Thomas Robinson. Thomas Robinson is a native of the District of Columbia, and he is a Ward 7 resident, born and bred. I want to tell you that he is an NBA player. Now he plays with the Portland Trail Blazers, and he was drafted as the number 5 pick overall in 2012 with at that time, the Sacramento Kings. What is really important, and that's a major accomplishment, that Mr. Robinson plays professional basketball. That is an accomplishment in itself. But let me tell you, he is a graduate, a high school graduate, a college graduate. He attended Eastern High School for a couple of years, and then he went on to boarding school at Brewster Academy in New Hampshire, where he graduated as an honors student. He went on to the University of Kansas, and he is a college graduate. He was then drafted to play with the Sacramento Kings. He currently, and well, you know, we are Wizards fans here, Thomas. Are you a Wizards fan too? But he actually just recently played in the playoffs as a member of the Portland Trail Blazers. What's important, and let me tell you a little bit about Thomas's character and his will and determination. He had a bit of an obstacle and a struggle, and I want to take you back to his 2011-2012 season in school. He actually encountered a tragedy, a triple tragedy. Within 1 month, his grandmother, his grandfather, and his mother all passed away in a single month. And Thomas, with determination and a strong faith in God, he carried on to finish his senior year, and he became the draft pick and the champion that he is today. Another thing about Thomas is that he never forgot, and he still remembers where he came from. And as a resident in the Fort Davis community in Ward 7. Every year, he comes back to the community and not only serves as a role model and mentor for the younger people in the community, he also gives back. He goes into his pocket. And right now he has pretty deep pockets. But he goes into his pocket and he provides his community. We have a Fort Davis reunion every year. He provides school supplies and backpacks for over 200 children in the community. And he also gives out bicycles to the young people. And not only does he do that in terms of, you know, in terms of gifts, he also tells them the importance of education, the importance of staying on the straight and narrow, and doing what's right. Not everyone's going to be an NBA star, but everyone can finish school, and everyone can stay off the streets and out of trouble. And Thomas is a prime example of that. So, Thomas, we have a resolution to present to you, but I just want to let you know you are the pillar of our community, a pillar in our community in Ward 7 and in the District of Columbia. You are our hometown hero on and off the court. We'll still cheer for you. We'll still cheer for you anyway. And I just want to acknowledge that the Council of the District of Columbia congratulates and recognizes Thomas for his professional and personal successes as a citizen, a native Washingtonian, an athlete, and now as an NBA player. And this resolution shall take effect, even though I didn't read all the specifics of it, but it was voted on actually in 2012. So it is law. It was voted on unanimously. And Thomas, we would like to congratulate you, honor you, and you have to say a few words. Let's give Thomas a round of applause. I'm sorry, before Thomas says anything, I have to acknowledge another friend and a public servant, Elijah Fagan. He is the manager of the Fort Davis Recreation Center, and he's known this young man since he was about 8 years old. Elijah, I commend him because I know we have a lot of public servants, and, you know, we think of so many government employees as just having a job. Well, Elijah goes a step beyond, and all of these young people with him, he serves as a mentor, a role model, and he really takes his job personally. He really adopts all of the young people at the rec center like they're his own. And Elijah, I commend you. Your job was well done. And we want more employees with our government agencies, with the Department of Parks and Recreation. We want more employees like Elijah to really encourage our young people and to be a role model for them. So thank you, Elijah, as well. And Thomas, come on up. We're so proud of you. Just say a few words.
I just want to say thank you, first of all, to everybody, Elijah, and everybody I don't know are here for this award. I really didn't do it for a war. I just felt that if you get a chance to get out of your neighborhood or out of the city, that it's a must that you come back and, you know, share with everybody else. So that's just my mindset, you know, just to try to help everybody around me. And thank you for this award again.
Government employees, and that's okay. But he is the manager of Fort Davis Recreation Center in Ward 7. So thank you all, and Thomas, just keep up the good work.
Thomas, can
thank you, Councilmember Alexander, and again, congratulations to Mr. Robinson. We'll proceed now to filing of committee reports and special reports. We have the Secretary's report. I believe this is of the Secretary's report of committee reports. Mr. McDuffie.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I move to waive the reading of the Secretary's report.
A motion has been moved to waive the reading. Is there discussion on the motion to waive? Hearing none, all those in favor of waiving the reading say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. We'll turn now to the Secretary's report of introductions. I want to note that a revised report of introductions was circulated at the beginning of this meeting, and that included on that report is a revised referral with regard to the Bill 20-805, which will be referred sequentially first to the Committees on Economic Development, Government Operations, and Finance and Revenue, and then to the Committee of the Whole. Recognize Mr. McDuffie.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I move to waive the reading of the Secretary's report of introductions.
There's been a motion made to waive the reading. Discussion? All those in favor of waiving the reading say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. Are there introductions of legislation by members? Councilmember Che? Councilmember Che?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Today, together with Councilmember Grasso, I'm introducing the Food Policy Council and Director Establishment Act of 2014. Over the past few years, we've passed important pieces of legislation to improve access to nutritious food and to build local food businesses and ventures. We have the Healthy Schools Act, the Healthy Tots Act, the Healthy Parks Act, the Feed DC Act, dealing with food deserts, among other things, providing extra SNAP benefits for people to use at farmers markets, urban agriculture legislation, and any number of other items. And so what we want to do is to establish a structure to continue to building on our success and have a food policy council and a director to achieve a comprehensive approach to food policy. The benefits will be to have a possibility of a comprehensive, coherent, effective, and efficient food policy. And related byproducts would be to have more national recognition for the progressive food policies that we do have, and the opportunities for collaboration with those jurisdictions. This legislation will address our food policy shortcomings by establishing this council. It will be aimed at improving food policy strategies and goals, and a food policy director lodged in the Department of the Environment to assist participants in our local food economy, attract new food ventures to the district, and engage with other jurisdictions on food policy matters. And I would like now to invite Councilmember Grasso, if he has any remarks.
Yes, thank you very much, Chairman Che. I appreciate the opportunity to co-introduce this legislation with you. We know that this is something that's desperately needed in the District of Columbia to organize all of the different aspects around food security here in D.C., and I'm just fortunate to be able to introduce it with you, and hopefully we can move this forward and get somebody strong in that position as soon as possible. Thank you.
And, Mr. Chairman, I would like to ask if there are any co-sponsors to this measure.
I'm sorry, Councilmember Jay.
And I wanted to ask if there are any co-sponsors to the measure.
Okay, you can ask.
Okay, so I'm asking.
Are there any co-sponsors?
Consider this the ask.
Are there co-sponsors for the legislation? Let me take the referral under advisement for
okay.
A couple minutes. Further, Councilmember Jay?
No, thank you.
Councilmember Alexander for introductions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My first introduction is the Copper Intrauterine Contraceptive Device Access Act of 2014. Copper intrauterine contraceptive devices, or IUDs, are long-term reversible birth control devices that are hormone-free and do not require any regular dosing. When compared to oral contraceptives, copper IUDs cost significantly less and are twice as safe for young women and are far more effective in preventing pregnancy with a failure rate of just 1%. Unlike some hormone-based IUDs, copper IUDs can safely be inserted immediately after a woman gives birth. This eliminates the wait for a follow-up appointment, which can take up to 6 weeks, and ultimately boost the effectiveness of the device. But even with all these clear benefits, the utilization of the copper IUDs in the District of Columbia are incredibly low, with a total of 10 Medicaid claims made in fiscal year 2012. This, in part, is attributed to the low reimbursement rate for copper IUDs when compared to hormonal birth control methods. Additionally, there is little incentive for physicians to recommend inserting copper IUDs immediately postpartum, as payment for the procedure immediately postpartum is included in a bundled rate together with other costs of labor and delivery. The Copper IUD Access Act requires the mayor to review the reimbursement and utilization rates for copper IUDs and submit a recommendation on coverage expansion to the council by January 1, 2015. It also authorizes a supplemental payment for copper-based IUDs to be inserted postpartum. It is my hope that these efforts will increase the availability of contraception to teen moms and encourage the early prevention of unwanted pregnancies. And I welcome any of my colleagues to co-sponsor. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I welcome any of my colleagues to co-sponsor. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Other co-sponsors on the legislation, Mr. Graham? This bill will be referred to Mr. Catania as a co-sponsor. Mr. McDuffie is a co-sponsor. This bill will be referred to the Committee on Health. Further, Councilmember Alexander?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. My last would be the Tenant Water Bill Notice Regulation Amendment Act of 2014, along with council members Barry Bonds, Catania, Graham, McDuffie, and Wells. This bill would require the District of Columbia Water and Sewer Authority, DC Water, to provide a copy of the water bill to the residential tenants, and it would also require DC Water to provide residential tenants with a notice of DC Water's intent to file a lien for unpaid water bills. While the obligation to pay a water bill lies with the property owners, it is not only the property owner who are affected. In some instances, tenants can have the bill in their name, but in many other instances, tenants must rely on their landlords to pay the bill, sometimes to the tenant's detriment. This bill aims to keep the tenant in the know. First, by making sure a tenant receives a copy of the pertinent water bill. Receiving a bill would provide the tenant with as close to landlord time knowledge of the water bill status so they can be ready for what might happen. Secondly, in those instances when the water bills have become so delinquent that DC Water resorts to placing a lien on the property, this bill would have tenants receive the same notice of intent to place a lien that the tenant would get. The idea is that with the right information sooner, tenants will have a better opportunity to act in accordance with their own best interests. This bill is not offered based on a belief that every landlord is a bad actor or that every harmful act of a landlord is intentional. However, my office has fielded constituent calls from renters regarding water bills in so many cases. The renters would have been able to proactively address the problem if they knew that there was a problem. So I yield any of my remaining time to any of my co-introducers, and I invite my remaining colleagues to co-sponsor. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Chairman.
Mr. Graham.
I just want to commend Councilmember Alexander on this bill because I think anything we can do to strengthen the position of tenants in the District of Columbia who are under such pressures right now, enormous, enormous pressures, and we know that rent control is beginning to fail us because of various strategies that are being used by landlords, in effect to move people out of affordable apartments and with affordable rents. And so this, when we give tenants the ability of knowledge about something that's going on, they're in a better position to act. And I think this makes a lot of sense. I also hope that legislation currently pending in the Economic Development Committee, which would also strengthen tenant rights, will be moved out and so that we can support that legislation this year. Thank you.
Are there co-sponsors for this legislation? This bill will be referred to the Committee on Transportation and the Environment.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, be a co-sponsor.
Mr. Orange will be a co-sponsor of this bill. I want to go back to the Food Policy Council and Director Establishment Act. That bill will be referred to the Committee on Transportation and the Environment with comments from the Committee on Business, Consumer, and Regulatory Affairs and comments from the Committee on Health. Councilmember Alexander, that concluded your introduction?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Councilmember Wells for introductions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Advisory Neighborhood Commission 6E Residential Parking Permit Exception Emergency Amendment Act 2014 permits former Advisory Neighborhood Commission ANC 2C residents who are now brought into ANC 6E to retain their Zone 2 residential parking permits effective immediately. I introduced a permanent version of this legislation earlier today. There exists an immediate need to permit ANC 2C residents who are now ANC 6E residents to retain their Zone 2 residential parking. Redistricting resulted in ANC 6E being landlocked by Wards 1, 2, and 5. Without this change, residents will only be able to move their cars 8 blocks from east to west and 9 blocks from north to south. No other area in the District of Columbia has parking zones surrounded by three different wards. Currently, Zone 2 signs still remain in this area, and according to the ANC Commission, the District Department of Transportation plans to change the Zone 2 signs imminently. The imposition of Zone 6 parking on residents in this ANC would create undue hardship where parking is already scarce due to the proximity of the Walter E. Washington Convention Center and many, many churches and religious activities all around in this neighborhood in Shaw. Unless this change is adopted, residents will not be able to go about their daily activities due to their inability to park. Additionally, New York Avenue serves as the southern boundary of the area that still remains Zone 2 residential parking permits. It is not practical for residents to park their vehicles south of New York Avenue as there are few residential parking spots, and many residents would be forced to regularly walk across a major roadway to their residences. This legislation would not create anything new, simply retains what's currently in place. There's no rational reason why parking policy and zones need to be dictated by political boundaries. Therefore, it should be noted that another Ward 6 neighborhood affected by the latest redistricting, Kingman Park, which is now Ward 7, they were allowed to keep their Zone 6 residential parking permit because, again, of undue hardship. And that has not been threatened with the conversion to Zone 7 to date. So I thank you and I invite support.
Thank you, Mr. Wells. Are there co-sponsors for this legislation? This is the permanent version of emergency that's on the agenda today. This bill will be referred to the Committee on Transportation and the Environment. Further, Mr. Wells?
That's it. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Are there any other introductions from members? Mr. Graham?
I have two bills to introduce. First is the Youth Offender Bill. And let me, I have the copies of this to distribute.
There's no water.
Hope not. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I'm joining, Councilmember Wells is joining me to introduce the Youth Offender Accountability and Rehabilitation Act. In my oversight of the Department of Youth Rehabilitation Services, I have kept two principles in the forefront. One is the importance of creating opportunities for rehabilitation of youth offenders, and the second is public safety. Almost all youth prosecuted in an adult criminal court in D.C. are sent there by a prosecutor in a process known as direct file. D.C. law allows prosecutors from the U.S. Attorney's Office to charge 16 and 17-year-olds suspected of specific offenses as adults. The prosecutor's decision to send a child to adult court via this direct file process is not subject to judicial review and cannot be appealed. Far less often, D.C. youth enter the adult system through transfer. In a transfer case, a child aged 15 or older is initially charged in juvenile court, but the Office of the Attorney General files a motion requesting that the case be transferred to the adult system. If the juvenile court judge determines that there are no reasonable prospects for rehabilitating the youth, really the child in many cases, the child, because people under the age of 18 are children in the District of Columbia. If he finds that there's no, if the judge finds that there's no reasonable prospect for rehabilitation, then the charges against the youth are handled in the adult system. Only 15 states in the District of Columbia give prosecutors sole discretion to charge children as adults without the involvement of a judge. This bill remedies that by creating a right for a minor defendant to move for a transfer of jurisdiction to the family court prior to sentencing and requires the court to hold a hearing on the transfer motion within 30 days. The legislation also sets out factors for the judge's considerations, and that's very useful. This bill will dramatically decrease the number of juveniles detained in adult facilities while awaiting trial. Let me give some context to this. In 2012, D.C. youth, D.C. children, spent 10,016 days in adult facilities, the equivalent of 27 years. For 58% of these days, the youth were awaiting trial and presumed innocent, awaiting trial and presumed innocent of the charges for which they are being held. There are, in fact, 541 children under the age of 18 who were incarcerated in adult facilities between 2007 and 2012. The D.C. Lawyers for Youth have provided us with your permission, Mr. Chairman. May I have another
minute? If there's no objection for a minute.
Because this is an important point. There was a recently published report, a very, very helpful and compelling document from the D.C. Lawyers for Youth entitled Capital City Corrections, which shows that children prosecuted as adults are more likely to reoffend than those who remain in the juvenile justice system. Also, adult facilities do not offer the rehabilitative programs youth need to turn their lives around. Finally, this bill requires that the Criminal Justice Coordinating Council collect data on this phenomenon. I want to say that I recently visited the adult facility in the D.C. jail with Councilmember Wells. And while they clearly are working toward some form of rehabilitation, the fact of the matter is that they're still in an adult prison. And I think to the maximum extent possible, we want children to be treated as children for the purposes of criminal prosecution. And where there's no possibility of rehabilitation, then they can be referred to the adult courts. But where there's a chance for change, let's keep children in the juvenile justice system. I welcome co-sponsors, and I've run over the time, but I don't know whether Councilmember Wells has anything that he would like to add to this.
Thank you for offering that. Are there co-sponsors to the bill? Councilmembers Berry, Grasso, Alexander, Bonds. This bill will be referred to the Committee on Judiciary and Public Safety. Further, Mr. Graham, with comments from the Committee on Human Services. Further, Mr. Graham.
Well, I would hope that you would reconsider that and that you would consider a sequential referral on this bill.
Due to the compelling nature
of the juvenile justice system being...
The Committee on Human Services has jurisdiction over the Department of Youth Rehabilitation Services.
The Committee on Judiciary Public Safety
has jurisdiction over the law with regard to juvenile justice.
Well, I'd like to prepare a memo for you arguing this bill, if I may, Mr. Chairman. The second bill that I have regards an alley closing in Ward 1. This is a public alley in Square 2892. The measure would approve the closing of a public alley in this square to permit the construction of a new 8-story mixed-use building with retail and residential space at 3210 to 3218 Georgia Avenue. The building will include 105 residential units, approximately 96,000 square feet, a good deal of which is going to be affordable housing. The building will also have 3,800 square feet of retail. The portion of the alley to be closed is in Ward 1 and is bounded by Georgia Avenue, Kenyon, Sherman, and Lamont. The section of the alley is currently gated and is not used for any service functions at all. Closure of this alley will not interfere with access to or from any other development in the square. The alley closing will enable the consolidation of several smaller lots into a single lot worthy of development. The alley closing has been reviewed and approved by ANC 1A, the Office of Planning, the D.C. Department of Transportation, and the Zoning Commission. 2,625 square feet of affordable housing units will be designated for households earning up to, but not more than, 50% of the area median income. And 5,000 square feet will be for households earning up to 80% of the area median income. The project exceeds the amount of affordable housing that would be required as a matter of right development. The project will be designed to meet a LEED Gold equivalent rating, which means environmentally it will be very, very sound. As a result of work with the Advisory Neighborhood Commission 1A, the applicant has agreed to hire the Ready, Willing, and Working program, a program providing jobs and job training to homeless and formerly and returning citizens and residents, to provide beautification and cleaning services within the ANC 1A09 boundaries. Mr. Chairman, I think this is a very, very credible and worthy project that merits our support. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Graham. Are there co-sponsors for this legislation? Councilmember Berry?
Bowser.
As a co-sponsor. This bill, and Councilmember Bowser?
Yes, and on the previous Graham bill, would you add me as a co-sponsor?
Well, which on the...
The youth rehabilitation.
All right, Councilmember Bowser will be added as a co-sponsor to Mr. Graham's... Youth offender bill.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Councilor.
Could you add me to this as a co-sponsor for this bill?
The alley closing bill? Councilor Bonds, the alley closing bill?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Bonds is a co-sponsor. This alley closing bill will be referred to the Committee of the Whole. Further, Mr. Graham? Are there any further introductions by members?
Mr. Chair?
Mr. Wells?
I'd like to be added to the bill from Councilmembers Grasso and Che regarding the Food Policy Council and Director Establishment Act 2014.
Mr. Wells will be added as a co-sponsor. Further?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Could you please add me as a co-sponsor to the Youth Offender Accountability and Rehabilitation Act of 2014?
Mr. Orange will be added as a co-sponsor to Mr. Graham's Youth Offender Bill. Further, we will turn now to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is most of page 1, all of page 2, all of page 3, and most of page 4 of the agenda.
Mr. Chairman?
Are there any changes to the agenda? Councilmember Alexander.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. If you could please remove from the consent agenda the Better Prices, Better Quality, Better Choices for Health Coverage Temporary Amendment Act on page 4F2.
Councilmember Chang?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Could you please remove from item B, number 2 on page 1, I believe it is? Oh, wait, it's now moved somewhere else. It's item B, number 2 on page 2, the Air Quality Amendment Act of 2014, for the purposes of an amendment.
Thank you. Further changes to the consent agenda?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilmember Bowser.
Would you please remove from page 4, item G1, a change order related to Powell Elementary School for the purposes of a statement?
Further? Hearing nothing else, what we have before us is the consent agenda with the following changes. Deleting on page 2, item B2, Air Quality Amendment Act of 2014, Bill 20-368. And on page 4, deleting at the top of the page, number 2, Bill 20-789, the Better Prices, Better Quality, Better Choices for Health Coverage Temporary Amendment Act of 2014. And on the same page, item G1, the change order numbers 1 and 2 to contract number DCAM-12M, et cetera.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Berry.
Chairman, I'd like to
remove change order G2.
G what?
G2. G2.
Change orders numbers 2 through 5. DCAM 12-CS-10152.
Yes.
All right, we have the consent agenda before us. I will not repeat all four deletions. I had repeated three, and Mr. Berry added number two on page four under section G. If there are no other changes, we have before us the consent agenda. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. We'll turn now to items on non-consent, and we'll begin with the items taken off of the consent agenda. Councilmember Che, with regard to Bill 20-368, the Air Quality Amendment Act of 2014.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I remove the bill from the consent agenda to make an amendment at the request of the Department of the Environment. The amendment would maintain the authority that the mayor currently has when issuing air quality permits to require permit holders to keep and submit records and compliance information and to install emissions and monitoring controls. The amendment would clarify that the proper authority for applying to the Superior Court for a warrant in the event the mayor is denied access to inspect a property to determine compliance with air quality laws, and it would simply, you know, make that, it would simply clarify that. And so I hope the amendment would be accepted as friendly.
I'll wait for everybody to have a copy and a moment for them to look at it. If there's no objection, this amendment will be accepted. Hearing no objection, it's accepted. Further, Councilmember Che?
No, I would simply move the bill.
All right, the bill is before us as with Councilmember Che's amendment. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. The next item, turning to page four, is the Better Prices, Better Quality, Better Choices for Health Coverage Temporary Amendment Act of 2014, Bill 20-789. Councilmember Alexander?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I request that this be withdrawn. The mayor has signed the permanent legislation, and it is on its way for congressional review. So there's no need for the temporary.
All right, the measure is withdrawn. I will turn now to the two items under G on that page four. The first is change order numbers 1 and 2 to contract number DCAM-12-M-1031H-FM, approval and payment authorization emergency declaration resolution of 2014. Councilmember Bowser, you wanted to speak to this?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to speak briefly about my support for moving forward with the addition and modernization of Powell Elementary School. I know a number of children and parents have been to the council to talk about Powell, and we're happy to see the money that has been promised for some time finally move so that this significant modernization could begin. This school is a success story of leadership and parents and people from the neighborhood deciding to invest in this school. The building is at capacity, and the addition is very much needed. It also speaks to the parents who are here wanting to make sure that the investments that they have made in Powell will bear out on the way to a middle school also in their neighborhood. So I also appreciate the council's attention to that. So that's, I wanted to speak in support of this measure.
Thank you. Is there further discussion? Just to be clear for the record, I'm moving this. All those in favor of the declaration say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have unanimously.
Chairman, can you please record me as voting present?
Mr. Grasso will be recorded as present, and the measure, the declaration is approved unanimously. I move the underlying bill, which is Bill 20-798. Discussion? All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, please record me as voting present.
Mr. Grasso will be recorded as present. The next item is change orders numbers 2 through 5 to contract number DCAM-12-CS-0152, approval and payment authorization emergency declaration resolution of 2014, PR 20-792. I move the declaration. Discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Berry.
I want to recuse myself, and Ms. Durant is now writing the official recusal along the same lines I usually use, knowledge of people, knowledge of operations, and et cetera. I'd like to be recused.
Ordinarily, I'm required to read the statement. I don't have that yet, but Mr. Berry will be noted as recusing himself on this. If there's no further discussion on the declaration, all those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed?
Mr. Chairman, please record me as voting present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grasso is present. Mr. Berry is recused. I move the underlying bill 20-804. Discussion? All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed?
Mr. Chairman, please record me as voting present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grasso is recorded as present. Mr. Berry is recused.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Berry.
The agenda, it has two change orders. And I want to just make sure I'm recused for both of those.
You were noted as recused from item 2 under G.
But there are two. That include both of them?
That was both the declaration
and the
bill.
That's fine, Mr. Chairman. Thank you very much.
We will turn now to the non-consent agenda, and the first item is Bill 20-22, Residential Real Property Tax Relief Act of 2014, which is before us because it was postponed from a previous meeting. Mr. Evans.
I'd like to move to postpone indefinitely.
There's been a motion to postpone indefinitely. All those in favor of the motion to postpone indefinitely say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. The next item on the agenda is Bill 20-671, the Wage Theft Prevention Amendment Act of 2014. Councilmember Orange.
Two minutes, Mr. Chairman.
Why don't we move to Fair Criminal Record Screening Act, and then we'll come back if there's no objection. So we will proceed to Fair Criminal Record Screening Act of 2014, Bill 20-642. Mr. Wells.
Hold for a moment. As you know, I gave, I've already given my introduction to this bill at the Committee of the Whole. And so the, so moved, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. McDuffie.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I have an amendment that I'd like to circulate. Mr. Chairman, as we discussed this morning during breakfast, the amendment that is about to be circulated would essentially provide two significant changes to the measure that Councilmember Wells introduced. The amendment would shift the time when an employer can conduct a criminal record to check to after the conditional offer of employment, not after the first interview. And the second part of the amendment would establish criteria by which an employer can rescind a conditional offer of employment as a result of the criminal background check. As the first change, I believe there was some degree of consensus, at least some support, that this was a positive change, but I will note for the record as well that according to the Society for Human Resource Management, the majority of employers do not conduct criminal background checks until after conditional offers are made, so this amendment will not create a sea change that some may be worried about. I believe most of the discussion this morning was regarding the second point, so I'm going to focus my comments on that. I think that is important to note that rather than making it more ambiguous by adding the factors which an employer must consider in making a decision to rescind an offer, we are in fact providing clarity and certainty for employers. Moreover, in the unfortunate circumstance that a complaint needs to be made to the Office of Human Rights, we will have provided the factors that they can consider in making a determination regarding whether an unlawful adverse action was taken against an applicant. Again, this reduces ambiguity and provides more certainty to the process for applicants, employers, and OHR. I will note, though, that there are still some outstanding concerns, and I've had an opportunity to discuss those with a number of my colleagues, so I'm going to move the amendment as it's currently drafted, and I made a commitment to work on the language that outlines the factors that the Office of Human Rights would consider, and I'm committed to do so. And I'm hopeful that this amendment will be accepted as friendly. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
I'll start with, is there any objection to the amendment? Is there any objection to the amendment?
Yeah, I object.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, is it a point of order?
A point of order?
Point of order.
Point of order.
Can we divide this amendment? It appears to have three parts. Can we divide it so that we don't have to?
It has to be a motion to divide, right? Or can I divide it? General counsel advises that I can divide this.
Yes, you can. It's a severance of.
It's a motion to divide.
It's a motion to divide. But he could just do it.
That may be the rule, but I'm going to. You're going to have to move to divide it.
I'll move to divide, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and how do you want to divide it? Into one and two?
I think there's one, two, and three, as I see here.
You want to divide it into each of its parts?
Well, we could have one. Yes, why not?
Motion to divide.
Mr. Chairman.
And I assume a motion to divide is debatable?
Mr. Chairman?
On the motion to divide,
Mr. Berry? Is there discussion?
Mr. Berry.
Mr. Chairman, usually Mr. Graham and I are on the same page, 96% of the time. But on this, I don't understand why the division. Unless I can better understand why the division, I'm going to vote against that division because it seems to me that Mr. McDuffie has been working with the chairman, Mr. Wells, and that I don't understand.
I could speak to the motion.
Could you explain to me, Mr. Graham, why divide?
Yes. I'm concerned about the subjectivity that is inherent, particularly in number two. Because I support number one, because that returns this legislation to the way in which it was originally introduced, and I was one of the co-introducers. But the subjectivity that is involved in amendment number two really is very great. And if you read it, Mr. Berry, you will see that there's a great deal of discretion. I mean, there is an effort here made to spell this out, but I think it gives a great deal of discretion. And maybe problematic discretion to the employer. Number three, I support. And so it's the second amendment where I think that we need to have separate discussion because of that subjectivity that's involved there. And so that's my reasoning. If you read it, Mr. Berry, you'll see what I'm talking about. That the specific duty is the employer's determination of a legitimate business reason must be reasonable in light of the following factors, which tells me that the employer himself has to review all of these factors, but there's no requirement that there be any reduction of all of this to writing, and so we don't know what's in the mind of the employer. It just makes this more ambiguous than I would like to have it, Mr. Barrett.
If I could. Mr.
So that's the reason that I wanted to divide the amendment.
Okay, I want to try to make sure that we don't spend an inordinate amount of time debating this.
Right.
The motion before us is to divide. The debate on the motion is to divide. Mr. Graham moved it and spoke to it. Mr. Berry spoken to it. Mr. Graham has spoken a second time. On the motion to divide, Mr. McDuffie?
I'm going to object to the motion to divide. I think Mr. Graham's concerns about there not being a requirement for employees to write things down are actually addressed in the amendment as currently drafted. It would require, or at least the applicant could request that the employer provide the applicant with information, which includes a copy or any and all of the records procured by the employer in consideration of the applicant or employee, including criminal records and a written statement. So I think there are some things that address the concerns that you just articulated, Mr. Graham, and I think that it's important that we take these two measures in concert, given the conversations and the robust debate that we had during the breakfast. There's an opportunity for us to address any concerns that you might have with that second part between now and second reading. And I've already committed to a number of my colleagues to work with them on that, and I'd be more than happy to work with you on it as well.
Mr. Chairman.
General Counsel has shown me the rule, which says that this motion is not debatable, but we've allowed some debate, so I will treat this as anybody can speak once to this motion. Councilmember Che?
Thank you. This is not just relevant to the motion to divide. I think it goes back to the original comments of Councilmember McDuffie, and I just want to have a clarification on that because it will determine how I vote on the motion to divide. Not only has Councilmember McDuffie said that he'd be willing to work on this to deal with the many issues that we brought up at breakfast, but I thought he also committed to putting it off until September, so we had a robust period of time to work on it. And so I wanted to know whether that was part of his promise.
That was not a part of my promise. That was it was a request made by one of my colleagues that I said I would consider, but I did not commit to that. What I committed to is doubling down on the effort to actually get language that might be satisfactory to that member who raised specific concerns. I understand the concern that they raised about trying to have more time. I don't know that we're going to need as much time as been requested to wait until the fall to address this. Perhaps we could address it before then. But I did not foreclose the idea that we might want to push it off. I just didn't make that commitment at this time.
Well, that was not my understanding when we had our conversation.
Further on this, anyone who has not spoken?
On the motion to divide?
On the motion to divide.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Wells and then Councilmember Bowser.
I'm not going to speak to it.
Councilmember Bowser?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And in it was a robust discussion that we had earlier and an important one, and I think that the issue that Mr. McDuffie puts on the table is really fundamental to how we move forward as a city in making sure that more opportunities are available across our city and for our residents that are having the hardest time finding employment. Having said that, I don't know that we've landed at the perfect place, and I think everybody around the table agreed to tighten the language that you refer to, Mr. Graham. I think part of the reluctance to divide this motion is that one without the other really doesn't provide a lot of relief or assurance to people who are conscientiously seeking a job, and I think that we have time to address very legitimate private employer concerns that they know that if they're working in good faith and following the law, that they won't be penalized. So my suggestion is that to divide them in some ways today won't help us get to the end result that we all seek.
Thank you, Councilmember Bowser. I would recommend that we do divide this as the based on the discussion at the breakfast. While there may be some opposition, there's relatively little opposition to number one, which is to delay the offer of employment, or rather the background check, until after a conditional offer of employment. I think that we can get out of the way, and the other two items, two and three, are more difficult, and I think that would be more rational. If there's anyone else who's not spoken on this, the motion before us is whether to divide the amendment. Mr. Orange.
Mr. Chairman, earlier I've indicated to Councilman McDuffie that he has my support, and in particular I was speaking to number one here. Now, in my view, one and three are okay. I do have some hesitation in seeing the amendment number two, because I'm seeing this for the first time, where it says an employer may only withdraw the conditional offer. And it just seems to me that that could be problematic. So I'm with you in saying number one, I don't believe is a problem at all. And I believe that we should leave here today with at least approving number one. Number three, I don't see a problem because it's just, in my view, it's only telling an employer that if you do terminate your conditional offer, please provide a written statement as to why you did this. But
two gives me a little pause. It just seems to be like a taking something away, which hasn't really had a full airing. And I'm wondering, could that full airing take place between today and the next time that we vote on this? But I remain committed to banning the box, and I think number one bans the box. But other issues have come up since that. And I can support one and three with no problem. Number two, I don't know where I am. It just gives me some pause.
Thank you, Mr. Orange. We have before us
Mr. the motion. Chair.
Mr. Wells.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I will not be voting to separate. And the main reason is that we've been trying to get this bill passed for 10 years, and we're very close to getting this passed. And one of the compromises made in this bill is that it's very clear. There's no private right of action. You cannot sue an employer for violating this. Is that it does not impact employers with 10 or less employees. That the fine, if you have 11 to 30 employees, is $1,000. The fine, if you're 31 to 99 employees, is $2,500. And the fine of 100 or more employees is $5,000. And if you repeatedly violate this, the fine does not go up. So if we don't get it perfect on there being a nexus on what's a reasonable, you know, business, you know, nexus there, if we don't get that perfect, what's at risk to the employer is a fine for violating this, not a private right of action. That is clear. So I think we have already erred on the side of the employer on that part. So I think the balance should tip to the employee. And in particular, because we have a terrible problem of so many returning offenders not getting employment, even though when they're qualified for the job. So this does tilt the scale in their direction, but it does it for a very clear reason and a public purpose. So it does not create a new protected class, but in some ways it does try to correct a wrong that once you have a conviction, that's basically it. It's an immutable characteristic in some ways. And so this really helps to do something around social justice. I do not support dividing these because then I think we'll lose it altogether.
All right, the motion is to divide this into three parts. All those in favor of the motion to divide, say aye. Aye. Opposed?
No.
The noes are.
Can the secretary call the roll?
Councilmember Che?
Yes.
Councilmember Che votes yes. Councilmember Evans?
Yes.
Councilmember Evans votes yes. Councilmember Graham?
This is on my motion to divide.
Correct.
Yes.
Councilmember Graham votes yes. Councilmember Grasso?
Yes.
Councilmember Grasso votes yes. Councilmember McDuffie?
No.
Councilmember McDuffie votes no. Chairman Mendelson?
Yes.
Chairman Mendelson votes yes. Councilmember Orange?
Yes.
Councilmember Wells?
No.
Councilmember Wells votes no. Councilmember Alexander?
No.
Councilmember Alexander votes no. Councilmember Barry?
No.
Councilmember Barry votes no. Councilmember Bonds?
No.
Councilmember Bonds votes no. Councilmember Bowser?
No.
Councilmember Bowser votes no. Councilmember Catania?
No.
Councilmember Catania votes no. Councilmember Orange?
No.
Councilmember Orange votes no. Mr. Chairman, there are 5 yeses and 8 noes.
The motion fails on a 5-8 vote. We have before us the full measure.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Barry.
Mr. Chairman, let me thank Mr. Wells for his diligence in this area. Remind the council that I had a similar bill that was very acrimonious among ourselves. So I'm glad that it has finally come to pass that our returning citizens will have some measure of protection. One thing we have to guard against is these employers who are good people are going to find ways to get around this. And we have to be careful, Mr. Wells, that we look at that, examine it, and that the Human Rights Office make sure they understand they can take these complaints. And job discrimination it's really hard to get at. It's clear to me that nobody expects a bank to hire a bank robber. That's clear. But what about all those persons, particularly with this failed war on drugs? The majority of our people who are locked up still has to do with substances, drugs, selling or distribution or using. And so we just have to be very, very careful to watch what happens and empower the Office of Human Rights to thoroughly investigate this. If there's a pattern that we see, all of us on the council are prepared to introduce and get past additional legislation to protect them. And so I want to thank you, Mr. Wells, for your diligence on this. You and I joined together on the decriminalization of marijuana. We've been together on a number of issues, and we won't be here next year, but we continue to work together on a whole range of things that affect this community and affect the returning citizens. The returning citizens don't have much of a voice, and so I've been encouraging them. We want 13 states would allow people to vote. And again, we got to mobilize ourselves to make sure we protect these good rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Berry. Further on the amendment.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilmember Che.
Yes, I just want to reiterate my concern about the language in the bill and how we can tighten it up. There was a lot of comment about that earlier at the breakfast, and I appreciate Councilmember McDuffie saying that he's willing to work on that. I had wanted him to commit, which I thought he had, but he said no, that he did not, to putting it off till September, but he just indicated to me that if it takes that long, he will wait that long to get this right and to get consensus on these points. On the underlying matter, though, it's quite plain that we need to do something about the issue about returning citizens and their ability to get employment. Not only does it address recidivism straight away, but just on the human and moral matter of giving people an opportunity to make their way in the world, I think this is crucial that we do this. So I don't want anyone to interpret my concern about the language for my lack of support for the underlying approach, which I do support wholly. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Catania.
Mr. Chairman, I would associate myself with the comments of Ms. Che. I support the amendment, but I think we have to be very careful about how we craft it because we don't want unintended consequences. Mr. Chairman, as I mentioned this morning, I spent some time as the vice president of a large multinational, and one of the things I was responsible for was the organizational development, which included this very subject of hires. A couple of years ago, the Department of Justice issued guidelines that actually spoke to the issue of ex-offenders in the context of civil rights claims. And the guidance from the Attorney General from the Justice Department 2 years ago suggested that because minorities, especially minority males, are so frequently caught up in the criminal justice system, that to use the categorization of ex-offender as an employment disqualifier actually rose to the level of a civil rights issue. And so much so that if you use that as a disqualifying factor, it would be viewed under the 64 civil rights claim as an adverse impact because of the overburden on a particular population of minorities. And so what we're having here is a conversation about what our law will do in the nexus with the federal law. And so to the extent that we actually do more to paper the issue, Mr. Wells is quite right. It does not create a private right of action, but if we're not careful, it very much will create civil rights action. And so these are actionable under federal law and the civil rights laws. So we have to be careful about, you know, are we setting employers up to find other ways to skirt the law and our intent? And so we need to be conscious of that. Hiring is an incredibly sophisticated exercise. It may not necessarily be intuitive, but under federal law, you have separate categories, each of which, if there's demonstrated adverse impact, can in and of itself create a federal civil rights claim. So an applicant pool is a specifically defined term of art. who is in the applicant pool and who is not. Interviews, who among us is actually interviewed and who is not. You can actually have federal civil rights claims if those who are actually in an applicant pool who aren't actually interviewed, if there's a disparate impact based on classifications, which can include whether or not we are interviewing people who were ex-offenders. Now, this is very complicated stuff. And the reason I raise it is because it's important that we get it right, because an adverse impact leads to a civil rights charge where attorney fees accompany the allegation. So you could have an environment, notwithstanding our very good intention, and I use the notion, the aspect of someone running an ice cream store on H Street who doesn't know all of this. And without, you know, candidly knowing their rights and responsibilities, if they make a misstep, not intentional, but a simple misstep, they can find themselves with not just a trip to the Office of Human Rights, but an actual Department of Justice-inspired civil rights claim, which can include attorney's fees on top of damages. We don't want to chill the very thing we wish to encourage, which is encouraging people to hire returning citizens. But we have to know the implications, because it can be chilling for a small business who in good faith believes they've made a judgment in their business interests consistent with the law, but in the absence of guidelines, they simply don't know what they're doing. And so hopefully, Mr. Chairman, we'll have a chance for a second round so I can elaborate a bit further on why it's important that we get this right if we really do want to accomplish the underlying ambitions of the legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. Further on the amendment.
Chairman.
Second round for Mr. Graham. Two minutes.
This is not a second round.
Yes.
We had a motion to divide. I haven't.
Correct. That was your first.
This is the first time I'm speaking to the bill itself.
Mr. Graham,
is there a second round?
You know, are we serious about this or are we not serious about it? That's what it's about. You know, I mean, somebody who has been charged with a crime, convicted of a crime, sustained the punishment of that crime, whatever it was. You know, is this to follow them all the way through their lives, at every turn, at every employment application? Is this to be brought up again and again and again? I mean, I think there's a real fundamental violation of civil rights in this regard, because it should be over. I mean, you've done your time. Now, would I hire a bank robber at a bank? Probably not. But would I hire a bank robber to do something else that was unrelated to banks or banking? That might be something very different. But the point is, with that exception, people ought to be considered as having done what they've done, and it's over. Because if we don't do this, I hear from my constituents about theft from auto, and I hear about robberies and muggings and everything else. If we want to parlay this into just more crime in the District of Columbia, then we should find a way where ex-offenders, returning citizens, and returning residents of the District of Columbia, you know, we should find a way so that they just can't get jobs. 50% unemployed is what Mr. Wells has told us. 50% unemployed. 30,000 returning citizens and returning residents without jobs in the District of Columbia. What are they to do? What are they to do? And so I'm serious about this, and that's why I'm uncomfortable with Amendment Number 2. I'm uncomfortable with the fact that there's no right to appeal this. I mean, if you're denied employment on the basis of a former criminal conviction that may have happened and be years ago and may be totally unrelated to the employment, and you have no right to appeal this, you have no right to seek redress of this violation of your rights. I mean, it says to me we're not really serious about this. The D.C. government, pursuant to legislation which I co-introduced, has this ban the box in place. Now, I'm not aware of any major problems associated with that in the D.C. government. It's a much stronger provision than what we have before us today. So I think what it comes down to, Mr. Chairman, is for us to determine, do we want to really give ex-offenders, returning citizens, returning residents, a chance to put their lives back together, a chance to serve their families and serve themselves with gainful employment? Do we want to give that opportunity or not? And I think the way this bill is currently drafted, the message is that it's very mixed in terms of
Mr.
what
Graham,
we really are interested in.
Your time has expired. Further on the amendment, Mr. Catania, second round.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to be clear. I support the direction, but we have to also appreciate the balance that has to be struck, and that's why Section 2 is so critical. Often, you're right, you know, a person's previous experience, you know, is not indicative of whether or not they can do the job. But there are some instances in which it is very important to know a person's past. And I want to give the example, and the reason Section 2 is so important is it allows, because there are no such things as bright lines in this category. If you're running, you know, in my world of chairing education, we have individuals who are teachers and who are interacting with children, and it's important to know whether or not a person is a registered sex offender. It's important to know that, and parents want to know that. And, you know, one of the considerations you take in when you're reviewing a person's record and the reasons why you need Section 2 is because you look at how many times has a person perhaps been convicted, the time between the conviction and seeking the employment. I think we can all agree that a conviction that is 10 years old has very different relevance than one that is 10 minutes old. And ultimately, who's going to bear the costs associated if something were to happen? And I realize this is an extreme example. If the company is required to hire someone who has a relatively fresh conviction for sex offending, is then put in an environment and they reoffend, and who is to be held accountable? Certainly, who will be held accountable will be the company, the daycare center. And so we need to just be conscious of this, and that's why I think Section 2 is a good start, and I commended Councilmember McDuffie for thinking about it. But it's not always a bright line as to when it's relevant and when it isn't. And you have to, and we have to give an opportunity for individuals to make good faith mistakes, but I think it's incumbent upon us to make sure we give them as much guidance as possible as to where the lines are. Whether it's a daycare center or whether it's the ice cream store on H Street, people who are running businesses do not necessarily and are not necessarily experts in line drawing. And if we're going to hold them responsible, we have to give them as much guidance as possible so that they know what they're allowed to do and what they're not allowed to do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Berry on second round.
Second round. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I didn't complete my statement. I asked some questions earlier. But I want to commend Mr. McDuffie. Let me just note that Mr. McDuffie has been a federal prosecutor, which means he knows the ins and outs of criminal law, and the Civil Rights Act. And I'm satisfied. I don't understand every part of this 100%, but I understand what Mr. McDuffie is trying to do. I think he's trying to tighten up the situation rather than loosen it up. I was just reading here. One of the things that we all agree on is that one interview is not sufficient. That it has to be after a conditional offer has been made. We all support that. And I support the rest of this in terms of course, it could be argued that the language is not tight enough. I don't agree with that. I'm not a lawyer. Other lawyers on the panel may have a different point of view. But I believe it's time for returning citizens to have a fair chance. I don't think this goes far enough, quite frankly, because an applicant is under the scrutiny of the employer. And believe me, I've been in this business long enough to know that these employees, if they want to hire you, they'll find any and all excuses not to do so. So, Mr. McDuffie, I want to commend you for this amendment, trying to tighten it up, and I intend to support this amendment. I intend to support the bill. People saying, well, let's go this way, let's go that way. Leave the lawyers who are raising these questions. And I'm not a lawyer. I know a lot of lawyers. I have a lot. And so I have to. You know, I got a lot of preachers and a lot of lawyers. And they've kept me, with God's help, in good stead. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Berry. We have before us the amendment.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Orange.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I will be supporting the amendment here today, and in particular, wholeheartedly, 1 and 3. And we'll talk with Mr. McDuffie between now and the next time we vote on this to look at number 2. I would also just want to let my colleagues know that they should also look at the mayor's letter on the subject matter. He's supporting this as well, although he does raise the concern that I think some of us are raising here today. And he states it's not currently clear whether this bill will permit an employer to inquire about pending criminal matters as well as convictions, or to limit an employer's inquiry to criminal convictions only. Additionally, there is the potential for confusion regarding when the bill authorizes an employer to request an applicant's criminal conviction history, but also, is this really just restricted to criminal history? There could be other things that could come up as well. So I think Councilman McDuffie has done a great job in bringing us this forward, and I'm certainly going to join in with him and Councilmember Bowser on this amendment today. And I do want to once again acknowledge Councilmember Berry, who's been fighting banning the box for a very long time. I joined in with him in his legislation, and you know, it just takes us to keep moving forward, to keep on fighting until we can get to a point where we can pass a bill that helps our returning citizen population. And today we will be able to do that, and I wholeheartedly will be voting in favor of the bill. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Graham, you've already spoken twice.
And no, I've only spoken once on the bill. I made a motion to divide, which
I understand
is a procedural
that was
matter.
Your first opportunity. That was your first round.
I think that's a very unfair interpretation.
Mr. Chairman.
I'm trying to move the debate along here because we have the bill after this amendment.
I have a brief statement to make, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Graham.
Mr. McDuffie, may I ask, in amendment number 3, you state that the failure to provide a written statement of denial upon request, explaining why the job was withdrawn, the job offer was withdrawn, would create a rebuttable presumption. As a lawyer, and Mr. Berry has referenced lawyers, as a lawyer, what is the operational effect of creating a rebuttable presumption against the employer if there's no appeal of this matter? Well, where does the rebuttable presumption
just
occur?
To clarify, I know you made a statement earlier, Mr. Graham, that there's no way to seek redress. Actually, the bill, not my amendment, but the bill that Councilmember Wells has that I am amending, gives a potential employee and an applicant the ability to seek redress before the Office of Human Rights. And that's where this would come up right here. So the section that we're debating right now on the amendment is operational when it becomes before the Office of Human Rights.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I'm going to support this today, this amendment, with great reluctance because of my concerns about Amendment 2 and 3, but I'm so enthusiastic about the First Amendment, which restores the original language of the legislation, that it's very, very important that no inquiry be made until after a conditional offer of employment is given, is so near the heart of all of this that while I would have preferred to see this divided so I could have voted against the separate amendments, the importance of Amendment Number 1 is so great for me that I'm going to support this on the premise that we're going to work on this language between now and first and second reading. So I just wanted to make that clarification.
Thank you, Mr. Graham. Councilmember Bonds?
Thank you, Chairman. I wanted to just speak a little bit on number 2, which we've been addressing. And I think that the language that is in number 2 of the amendment is very clear in that, and the offer of employment can be withdrawn if there is a legitimate business reason. And a legitimate business reason in the examples that Mr. Catania offered are very clear. If it's determined you're a sex offender, then the legitimate reason would be that you would not be working with children. If you are a bank robber, you would not be working in a bank. So I think that this amendment, points 1, 2, 3, are very good. It's an opportunity for us in society, the District of Columbia society, where we know that 50% of 60,000 persons are come home from serving their time and they're not made whole. It gives us an opportunity for that. So I'll be supporting the amendment, and I thank the maker of the amendment, Mr. McDuffie, for hearing us all out and being steadfast. And I especially thank my colleague, Mr. Wells, for just going to make this happen finally, I hope. Thank you.
Councilmember Catania.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chairman.
This is a question, if I might, to the chairman of to Mr. McDuffie. Between first and second reading, if Mr. McDuffie would be willing to consider, you know, some type of strategy to alert employers exactly what these guidelines mean. And so, in response to the previous speaker who mentioned that, well, it's obvious that if someone has been a child molester, they shouldn't be able to work in a daycare facility. Yes. That's not what the law currently is. The law actually puts limitations on how many years back, even for those particular crimes, that you can hold a person accountable for. And so it is a 7-year, more or less, soft, you know, in litigation and guidance around the country. Going back more than 7 years, even for a relevant crime, you can't hold that person accountable even for a relevant crime. And so I just think that giving some guidance to employers would be helpful. For instance, if you are that ice cream shop on H Street, how would you know how to gauge the age and what it means of the person when they engaged in a criminal offense? How would you know how many years you can hold a conviction against a person? You're in the business of selling ice cream. You're not in the business of knowing the nuances of what is very sophisticated case law and guidance on the subject. And so my question, Mr. Chairman, is to you, to Mr. McDuffie, if between now and the next reading, if we could look to create some guidance for employers who may not know and make it publicly available so that they will know, so they don't inadvertently stumble into a mistake that they are, you know, it's not their subject matter expertise.
In 20 seconds, Mr. McDuffie.
I'll try to keep it brief. You know, it's my intention to try to get as much of this, what we're doing here today, out to employers so that they have that guidance. I will say, though, that, you know, what you referred to earlier, Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 has been on the books for quite some time, and there are already sort of provisions that prevent employment discrimination. There's also guidance, which I think was very relevant, that you mentioned during the breakfast, which is the enforcement guidance on the consideration of arrests and conviction records and employment decisions under Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which the EEOC has already published. And so I think there are things that already exist that employers should already be familiar with when they make hiring decisions. But absolutely, I think it's worth making sure that we try to inform as many district-based employers, both private and government, as to what the law would be if and when it's passed.
Thank you. Councilmember Bowser.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to agree with much of what has been said today, and that and I especially want to make my points clear, because when this issue was before us about a year ago, I wasn't able to support the direction that it was moving in creating a private right of action, because I did think that it would prevent employers from even looking and hiring in the district of Columbia. And since and over the past year, of course, I've talked to a lot of young people, a lot of middle-aged people, and a lot of people just trying to make their way in the District of Columbia who have mistakes in their background and who have paid their debt to society. Likewise, I have the experience of being on a board that employs 11,000 people, where this background issue has been a significant issue at Metro. And so I recognize from the employer's point of view that they have to protect their operations and practices, and it is very important to have clear business and hiring practices as it relates to hiring returning citizens. So I commend Mr. McDuffie, and I agree to support him on this and encourage everyone else to do so as well, because I think for sure that the first part of the amendment gets us to where we need to be. and that we can spend the next couple of weeks or however long it takes refining Section 2. I agree with Mr. Orange's kind of focus on making sure we get Section 2 right. I think what's important for us to tell the employment community is that we need them. The government can't hire every resident of the District of Columbia, and we know that the private sector hires a lot of our residents. And what we need to make clear is that the employer's existing policies perhaps need to be updated for what we wind up with this law, but their policies and practices also need to be respected. And so it needs to be perfectly clear what their obligations to the law will be, and that the law recognizes that they need to put the policies in place that will help them operate their business. So I will look forward to supporting this today.
Mr. Evans.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. After all the discussion, I'd like to move to close debate.
Motion's been made to close debate, the effect of which is that anyone who has not spoken will still be able to speak. Everyone else will not be able to, except for the maker of the motion. All those in favor of the motion to close debate, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. Further on the amendment.
If I could, Mr. Chair.
Mr. McDuffie.
Just to close out, I want to thank Councilmember Wells again and his staff for the work that they've done in committee on this bill, as well as Councilmember Barry, who introduced the original bill. I think it's so important that we move forward with this today. This is a critical piece of legislation, in my humble estimation, for the District of Columbia. And I think it speaks volumes to where we are here in the city. When we talk about the 60,000 people in the District of Columbia who have a criminal history, when we talk about the 8,000 residents who are returning to the District of Columbia each year from periods of incarceration, what we want to tell them is, if you finish and you've paid your debt to society, we want to give you a fair shake. And that's all we want to give them. We're not requiring private employers to hire anybody. What we're saying is, if somebody has been convicted of a crime, you should look at that information only after you made a conditional offer of employment, where you've judged them on their qualifications and at their merits. And I think it's a modest request, and I think it's worth this council moving in that direction. I really do appreciate the questions that have been raised today, because I think they've been legitimate questions that we need to consider. And I really look forward to working with my colleagues to passing this today, but also making sure that it's the strongest bill possible as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you. We have before us the amendment. All those in favor of the amendment, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, say nay. Nay. The ayes have it by majority vote. Further on the bill.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
I have an amendment that I want to circulate. And this amendment is consistent with the discussion in the committee of the whole, where I asked Mr. Wells, with regard to the definition of inquiry, if it could be clarified to say intended to gather criminal history information, and the other part of this is to simply clarify through punctuation 2BA. If there's no objection, this would be accepted.
Chairman, I object so it can be explained.
What this amendment does is it clarifies that the definition of inquiry means any direct or indirect conduct intended to gather criminal history information from or about an applicant.
Does this strengthen or does it weaken the bill?
It clarifies.
That's not the answer. My answer, my question was, because I just got it about 2 minutes ago, haven't had a chance to read it or discuss it, and my question was very direct. Does this clarification strengthen the bill or weaken the bill?
If you support the bill, I believe it strengthens the bill.
All right. Let me ask Mr. Wells the same question. Do you think that this clarifying amendment strengthens the bill or weakens the bill.
Well, if I may, Mr. Chair.
Yes, Mr. Ross.
I know that what the chair brought up in breakfast this morning is he was concerned that if someone just did a Google search on somebody and inadvertently found information of a prior arrest, that you'd be in violation of the law. And so I believe that the intent of the law is fairly clear, but I don't believe that it weakens the law to clarify the meaning that the search be related to looking for a criminal history prior to interview and offer. So I accept the amendment as friendly, but of course without objection. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wells. Thank you, Mr. Berry. On this amendment?
Yes, on this
Mr.
amendment.
Mr. McDuffie.
I appreciate what you're trying to do here with this amendment. I just, for the record, I think this perhaps could have some unintended consequences, though. The example that you raised about, you know, somebody Googling an applicant for a job, I think is an important example because perhaps you want to allow employers to be able to do that and come up with information that perhaps relates to character, and that this would limit it to criminal history information. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. My concern is that a Google search could perhaps reveal criminal history information that would disqualify a person before you get to the conditional offer of employment. So I just wanted to make sure that the record was clear on that.
Thank you. If there's no objection, the amendment is accepted.
I object, Mr. Chairman. I want to ask a question. Does this prevent an employer from Googling into the criminal history of an employer, of an applicant? Does it?
What this amendment does is consistent with what Mr. Wells has explained and what others have said, which is that this bill is to not only ban the practice of requiring an applicant to identify whether they have a criminal record, but also to prohibit an employer from inquiring about a person's criminal record. The definition of inquiry is so broad that it prohibits any kind of an inquiry. And this amendment is to clarify that what this bill is about is an inquiry directed at a person's criminal background.
Does it prohibit it?
Prohibit what?
An inquiry into criminal background.
It does not change the meaning of the bill, which I believe is to prohibit an inquiry into a criminal background. It does not change the meaning of the bill.
But the answer is that it does prohibit inquiries into criminal histories by any means.
The language of this amendment is to clarify that what is prohibited is an inquiry into the criminal history of an applicant.
By any means.
Correct. It says that the amendment doesn't speak to the rest of the bill, which says
using any method,
including application forms, interviews, and criminal history checks.
If it does that, I withdraw my objection. And I'd like to speak to the bill itself.
If there's no objection, the amendment is accepted. The amendment is accepted. Further on the bill.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Grasso.
Yes, I want to thank you, and I want to thank Councilmember Wells for taking the lead on this legislation. I co-sponsored this bill when it was introduced in January because I believe it is important for us to begin to rethink and retool our approach to supporting our returned citizens. Our criminal justice system is too often focused on vengeance and punishment rather than on crime prevention and the social and economic reintegration of released prisoners into our communities so that they are in a position to succeed. Last month, I spent a full weekend in a maximum security prison working on a program with 25 inmates around nonviolence. And of those 25 inmates, 23 of them were African Americans, and the average age was about 21 years old. All but two of them were in there for nonviolent offenses. So what I noticed in there most kind of importantly is that they had very little opportunity for improvement. They didn't have a college degree program. They didn't have quality health care. They didn't have mental health facilities. They had basically been written off. And this was maximum security. These folks were in there for 10 years or more. What I noticed when I got out of that program and when I was reflecting on this was that this was young people, young men, who were going to be returning back to the community. And the fact of the matter is that our society has completely failed them. We have put them in a position to fail time and time and time again. And I think that, you know, ultimately, and, you know, if we're going to pass this bill, which I think is very important and I support this bill, the fact of the matter is this is one small token to what we can actually do to make sure that we're reforming the criminal justice system in this country and in this city. So I'm, you know, fully supportive of this, and I think it's important for us to move forward. I think it is foolhardy to believe that the employment or the employers or the business community can solve this problem for us. And what we're doing is we're putting people in jail. We're throwing away the key in some instances. I met one young man who's 22 years old and has 10 years still, and all he ever did was deal drugs. And so we have to stop the war on drugs. We have to stop the way that we're addressing criminal justice problems in our country and our city. So last year I introduced a record sealing bill for nonviolent drug offenders so that the ban the box question is not even on the table. And if you take and you pass my legislation, what you would see is a immediate relief for 23,500 District of Columbia residents who would no longer have to check the box or be required to check the box. And that would take this conversation off the table completely. So I'm going to support it today because I think it's important for us to also have the business community in partnership with us. But I think this council and this legislative body and the mayor need to take seriously the fact and the impact that we're having on our residents who we're sending away to prison often in faraway states. And the fact of the matter is we're not giving them the tools they need to succeed when they return to the District of Columbia, including education, including mental health care, including physical health care, prior to release and post-release. So, Mr. Chairman, I'm going to support this legislation, but I think that this city has a long way to go to get it right.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Berry.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And again, let me commend Mr. Wells, and also to point out, as Mr. McDuffie has done, and Ms. Orange, I tried diligently to get this through this council. It got to be very acrimonious. I'm glad that people have seen the light now. But this is just a small point, as Mr. Carrasco made. The whole criminal justice system is biased against African Americans and Hispanics. Now, there's some in this council don't want me to ever mention race. But race is a relevant factor. On the 8,000 people who come back, have a double whammy. They're returning citizens, and 98% of them are African American. So they have two hurdles to pass, the race hurdle, and then they got to pass for women, the gender hurdle. There's gross discrimination still. And this is just one small step. I don't want anybody to leave here thinking that this is going to move us light years ahead. Mr. Wells understands that. This is just one small step. We should not let up. I welcome your bill, Mr. Jarrah. So when are you going to bring it? I want to vote for it.
It's been introduced and it's in committee now, Mr. Berry.
What committee is it in?
Judiciary.
Judiciary. Well, I certainly want to follow it very closely because you're right. It would take care of about 23,000 people. Mr. Chairman, let me also point out that these crimes of economics, drug selling, armed robbery, burglary, theft. All of these are economic crimes. And the way you solve the economic crime is to provide skill training for those who are coming back, which they don't have hardly any. And for not only skill training, but get the business community to understand it's to their benefit to hire returning citizens. Because there are three ways that I've thought about that you get money. You inherit it, and most of us don't inherit anything. You make it because of the skill level of a lot of the people, because of the bias against them, they can't make it, or you take it. The majority of people I've talked to don't want to go back to prison, don't want to continue doing what they were doing. but they're forced to, in a lot of instances, to survive. And I wanted to make it very clear that it's more than 30,000 out of work. It's more like 40 or 45,000 out of work. One out of work is too much for me. But, Mr. Weld, I commend you for getting this far. But I don't want us to go to sleep and think that, as Mr. Carrasco said, that this is the end-all, be-all. I'll wait your bill. I'm ready for that bill.
And thank you, Mr. Berry.
Talk to Mr. Wells about getting it out quickly. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Further on, the bill is amended.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Wells.
Just want to acknowledge that, as Mr. Berry stated, he's worked on this issue. A number of other people in the council that are here or not here have worked on this issue, and that we are finally getting this done after almost 10 years of addressing this particular issue. And it's certainly not something I'm doing alone. I'm doing with the rest of the council here. I appreciate Mr. McDuffie's addition to the bill and trying to make it right. The only concern I have is that there's a reason why this bill has not passed for almost 10 years. And we should not delay. We should not allow. This should be passed by second reading before recess. We don't want to allow mischief or any other reasons that seem unrelated to stop this bill. It's been stopped before. So I believe I am fully agree with Mr. McDuffie that whatever changes, alterations, tightening of language, any of those things can be done within the period of time before the next time that we vote on this bill. So I will not support any effort that delays a vote on this bill for the second reading that goes in beyond, you know, to September. We need to do this before recess. We need to get it done. And we, as this council, it is our opportunity to get this done this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wells. Further on the bill. All right, we have the bill before us as amended. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Please record me as voting no. The bill passes. The next item, we're going back in the agenda to Wage Theft Prevention Amendment Act of 2014, Bill 20-671. Mr. Orange.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm pleased today to present Wage Theft Prevention Amendment Act 2014, and everyone should have in their possession the amendment in the nature of a substitute. The preamble of the bill basically is to amend the Wage Payment and Collection Act, the Minimum Wage Act Revision Act of 1992, the Recruit Sick and Safe Leave Act of 2008, and Chapter 9 of Title 7 of the District of Columbia Municipal Regulations to enhance applicable remedies, fines, and administrative penalties when an employer fails to pay earned wages, to provide for suspension of business licenses of employers that are delinquent in paying wage judgments or agreements, to clarify administrative procedures and legal standards for adjudicating wage disputes, to require the employer to provide written notice to each employee of the terms of their employment, and to maintain appropriate employment records. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank those on my committee who worked out the appropriate language, which is found on page 2 of this amendment in nature of substitute, where it states when an employer is a subcontractor alleged to have failed to pay an employee any wages, the subcontractor and the general contractor shall be jointly and severally liable to the subcontractor's employees for violations of the Living Wage Act. The subcontractor shall indemnify the general contractor for any wages, damages, interest, penalties, or attorney's fees owed by the general contractor as a result of the subcontractor's violation of this act or the Living Wage Act, unless those violations were due to general contractor's lack of prompt payment. Also want to point out in this bill that we will have written notice where every employer shall furnish to each employee at the time of hiring a written notice, both in English and in an employee's primary language, containing the following: the name of the employer, the physical address of the employer, and most important, the employee's rate of pay and the basis of the rate. In addition to that, the employee's regular pay day designated by the employer, so a person will know their rate and the date on which they will be paid. Also, please, that this act also addresses the burden of proof. And the burden of proof is such that it's on the complainant at first, but if it's determined that the employer has not kept records and that has done a number of things, that the burden of proof shifts to the employer and the complainant can move forward. Also, there was a question as to when would this bill be applicable, and it states on page 42 of the Amendment in Nature of Substitute that this act shall apply as of October 1, 2014. So, Mr. Chairman, I'm pleased to present this bill. And I want to say thank you to Councilmember Jim Graham and Councilmember Mary Che for being co-introducers with me, as well as to the, I believe, the other seven co-introducers on this bill. And I would move for unanimous approval of the Wage Theft Prevention Amendment Act of 2014. So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
The measure is before us. Mr. Berry?
Thank you very much. I want to really commend Councilmember Orange for staying the course. We've had hearing after hearing, and I'm glad to see all of you who come down to support it. Let's give yourselves a round of applause. I want to do that.
Mr. Berry.
All right.
Mr. Berry, I would appreciate it. You, as you know, demonstrations are not permitted during meetings, and I would appreciate if you would not encourage that.
I can't stop doing that, but I go on. Mr. Owens, you would be commended for staying the course. We had example after example where employers would withhold the wages, call people in to work, not give them overtime. We still had to be very vigilant because some of these employees are very treacherous in terms of how they treat these employees. So I want to commend Mr. Orange, commend you who have come to watch these proceedings. I intend to give a resounding yes to this. It's long overdue. Mr. Owens, you delayed it because somebody asked you to do this and do that. But we're now at the time, Mr. Owens, where justice will roll down like water, like a mighty stream, as Dr. King said. So wage theft, this is not a panacea. We got to be vigilant. So all you workers, be vigilant. Let me know, let Mr. Orange know of anything. I'm going to put a staff person on it to follow it, to watch it, to make sure you all get your wages. Thank you so much, Mr. Orange. And thank you for the other co-introducers who have done that. And I'm ready to vote, but I just want to at least speak positively on this bill so the workers of Washington know they have an ally down here, and at least seven of us on the council, and to be vigilant. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Berry. Mr. Graham.
Well, I'm glad to be back in agreement with Mr. Berry.
It's about time.
After his lapse on the returning citizen issue. Let me just say that the worst forms of wage theft are impacting our immigrant population in the District of Columbia. And I want to be very clear about this because someone previously used the word citizen to talk about this bill. And wage theft comes in all different varieties, but having attended an afternoon session in Mount Pleasant where I heard testimony after testimony after testimony of immigrants who were abused by employers, who were knowledgeable about the immigration status and thought they could get away with it, it wouldn't make any difference. Because who would complain? Who would complain if there was no work permit? So we're just not going to pay you. Oh, you're not going to pay me. I did all the work. You're not going to pay me. Yeah, that's right. This is the story that was told over and over and over again. And so today, while we recognize that there's all manner of differences in terms of the types of wage theft that occur, we are acting today to stop the exploitation of immigrant workers. And this is something that is very important. Every city and every jurisdiction in the United States ought to do something similar because there are absolutely awful things that are being happening. Now, the immigration issue is a complex issue, and I know it is a complex issue. But the fact of the matter is that this country could not operate, could not function in so many different ways but for immigrant labor, but for people who are here legally or illegally, who make the wheels turn. who make the wheels turn both in agriculture and commerce and industry. And, you know, so whenever I hear this immigration argument and I think to myself, you know, if the employers, the major employers who benefited from immigrant labor were really honest about it, they'd say we can't do without this. But in the process of exploiting this source of labor, there are also major examples of wage theft and wage abuse. And so I want to thank also those of you who are here today. Many of you brought compelling personal stories about how you had done the work, but somebody knowing of your immigration status said, the heck with you, I don't have to pay you. And so can you imagine any of us reacting to that situation where we had actually performed the work that we were hired to do, and then the person said, well, you're not going to get any money for it. And so I think this is a real definition of a progressive step by this council in terms, and I want to commend most particularly Council Member Orange for his leadership again on the issues of people who are most vulnerable in our society. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Graham. Further on the bill?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I just want to also applaud you for coming up with the $590,000 in the Budget Request Act so we can ensure that not only are we voting for this today, that in fact it can in fact be implemented properly, and the fact that it has an effective date of October 1, 2014. I know I did express some reservation in slowing down the process, but once again, this is a clear example where good things happen to those who wait. And in this process, we were able to tighten it up. Also want to thank the general counsel's staff for making sure that we brought in the Sick and Pave League, the Minimum Wage Act, the Living Wage Act, and we really tightened this up. Want to thank my staff, Mr. Fisher and Jillian, Irving and others for working extremely hard, and really want to thank my committee, because this is where a committee really worked hard and we stuck together. Councilmember Graham, Councilmember Che, Councilmember Grasso, and Councilmember Alexander for working this out in the committee and staying steadfast. So I believe this is a team victory, and the advocates, thank you so much for pushing and pushing, and I also want to thank the executive branch for being on board as well. So at the end of the day, all is well. Let's vote this, and let's get it implemented. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Orange. If there's no further discussion, we have before us the Wage Theft Prevention Amendment Act of 2014. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? I believe the vote's unanimous.
No, I feel it. A roll call. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Roll call.
The Secretary will call the roll.
Thank you.
Councilmember Evans. Councilmember Evans. Councilmember Evans votes yes. Councilmember Graham.
Yes.
Councilmember Graham votes yes. Councilmember Grasso.
Yes.
Councilmember Grasso votes yes. Councilmember McDuffie.
Yes.
Councilmember McDuffie votes yes. Chairman Mendelson.
Yes.
Chairman Mendelson votes yes. Councilmember Orange.
Yes.
Councilmember Orange votes yes. Councilmember Wells.
Yes.
Councilmember Wells votes yes. Councilmember Alexander?
Yes.
Councilmember Alexander votes yes. Councilmember Barry?
Yes.
Councilmember Barry votes yes. Councilmember Bonds?
Yes.
Councilmember Bonds votes yes. Councilmember Bowser?
Yes.
Councilmember Bowser votes yes. Councilmember Catania?
Yes.
Councilmember Catania votes yes. Councilmember Che?
Yes.
Councilmember Che votes yes. Mr. Chairman, there are 13 yeses.
Thank you,
Mr.
Chairman.
The measure passes. The next item on the agenda is the proposed resolutions.
Thank you.
The public is reminded that we're not supposed to have applause or other demonstrations during council meetings. The next item on the agenda is PR 20-798, the Ticketmaster LLC Ticketing Services Contract Approval Resolution of 2014. Mr. Evans?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This proposed resolution would approve the Events DC, which is the Washington Convention and Sports Authority multi-year agreement with Ticketmaster to provide ticketing services for events on the RFK Stadium DC Armory campus and other designated Events DC venues. The contract term is for 5 years from the date of the award. I'd like to move the bill at this time.
We have the resolution before us. Discussion. All those in favor of PR 20-798 say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Mr. Chairman, please record me as voting present.
The measure passes unanimously. Mr. Grasso is present. Turning to read and vote on emergency legislation, the first item is Heat Wave Safety Emergency Declaration Resolution of 2014. Councilmember Che.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. As we're about to enter the summer season, there exists an immediate need to protect district residents who are vulnerable to health impairments that may be caused by periods of extreme heat and who may be unable to cool their homes if their electricity is shut off. District law prohibits utilities from disconnecting their service when the forecast predicts the temperature will be 32 degrees Fahrenheit or below during the following 24 hours. But we know that exposure to extreme heat is, in fact, more likely than extreme cold to cause people to experience negative health consequences, including death. Yet the district does not prohibit the disconnection of electricity during or directly preceding periods of extreme heat, analogous to the prohibition on disconnections during or directly preceding periods of extreme cold. As we have recognized in past years with similar legislation, enacting a prohibition on the disconnection of electricity during or directly preceding periods of extreme heat will provide a measure of security for district residents without creating undue hardship for the electric company. So I move the declaration, Mr. Chairman.
The declaration is before us. Discussion. All those in favor of the declaration say aye. Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. On the underlying bill, Councilmember Che.
I move the bill, Mr. Chairman.
Discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Berry.
I want to commend Ms. Che for being steadfast in this. There are those who would like to try to divide us, but we're not going to be divided, Ms. Che, from each other, because it's important we have some civility as we make these discussions. And in a democracy, ought to be room for dissent, ought to be room for discussion. The Bill of Rights was the first amendment to the Constitution allowing free discussion. Not that anybody here suggests we shouldn't, but I want to go on record as commending Ms. Che for this bill. Thank you.
Further discussion? This is on the Emergency Amendment Act. All those in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. Advisory Neighborhood Commission 6E Residential Parking Permit Exception Emergency Declaration Resolution of 2014. Councilmember Wells?
So moved, Mr. Chair.
The declaration has been moved. Discussion? Mr. Evans?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to oppose the emergency that is being put forward by Councilmember Wells. Every 10 years when we go through redistricting, we change ward boundaries. And every time we do that, the ward boundaries align with the residential parking passes, and they do for a reason, so that residential parking was devised so that you can park near your home. They're not called commercial shopping parking passes. They're not called business parking passes or work parking passes. They're called residential parking passes. And they're devised so that when you come home at night or during the day, you can leave your car at your home, and your spots are not taken up by individuals who live in other neighborhoods or other wards. And so we've done that traditionally every time we've done redistricting, and this is no exception. The emergency Councilmember Wells is putting forward deals with the Shaw community, which was part of Ward 2 since the inception of ward boundaries. But like other neighborhoods that were part of Ward 2 at one time, were redistricted to another ward because Ward 2 had way too many people. This happened 10 years ago when the Palisades was moved from Ward 2 into Ward 3. And many people in the Palisades wanted to keep their Ward 2 stickers. Many people work downtown and can park near their place of employment in a residential neighborhood for free. Ward 2 contains more metro stops than any other ward in the city, any other jurisdiction in the metropolitan region, actually. And so one can drive to a metro stop at DuPont Circle, park in a residential neighborhood if you have a Ward 2 sticker, leave your car there all day, and ride the metro. These then take up spots from residents who live in these neighborhoods. Ward 2 is overcrowded now with cars. We are packed. We have no space. And so to allow residents of another ward to keep Ward 2 stickers
and then park in Ward 2 neighborhoods just doesn't work. If an exception is granted for this neighborhood, why not some other neighborhood? Now, the only time this was done, as Councilmember Wells mentioned, was when a portion of Ward 6 was put into Ward 7 on the west side of the Anacostia River. They were allowed to keep their Ward 6 parking stickers because they were separated by a huge river. That is not the case in this situation, where the Shaw neighborhood is not separated from the rest of Ward 6 at all. This does not, as is put forward, prevent someone from a neighborhood parking and going shopping. You are allowed, as you know, in a residential parking district area to park for 2 hours. You just can't leave your car there for more than 2 hours. And so it doesn't prevent anyone from going shopping, from parking in a neighborhood, for doing all of those activities. And so I would strongly urge my colleagues not to vote for this emergency. And then finally, this was a package put together when we did redistricting almost 2 years ago now. And to now change that package, I think it opens up to all kinds of requests to be made. And so if we want to do this, we should look at parking comprehensively across the city and come up with a new parking plan, not to just grant a exception for one neighborhood. So I would very much oppose this.
Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chair.
Councilmember Alexander.
Thank you. I just want to ask, because I know it did take place in Ward 7 and 6 with the redistricting, is this just a particular amount of residents that will be affected by this, or are they open? Because I think, Councilmember Evans, if I'm correct, your worry is that those residents that are on the border of Ward 2 and Ward 6 are going to then use their passes to park in Georgetown or wherever in Ward 2. Is that the concern? Because I do know, I do believe in Ward 7, even though it deals with the border residents on the 19th Street corridor, they could park anywhere on Barracks Road, Capitol Hill, anywhere with that Zone 6. So is that your concern? And if so, how could we just address that particular issue, that they could only park where they live? Their zone sticker would just apply to where they live.
It's twofold, Councilmember Alexander. What you just said is part of the concern, that someone with a Ward 6 parking sticker in the Shaw community, if they were to receive a Ward 2 parking sticker, can park anywhere in Ward 2. So if they were to work in Foggy Bottom or DuPont Circle, they could park there. If they wanted to take the subway to their place of employment, they could park there. So it does allow them to park anywhere in the ward, and again, where we have no parking spaces to take on another 10,000 individuals who may get these stickers. And then secondly, it does. Residential parking is meant to allow people to park in their neighborhood, not in someone else's neighborhood. So, again, having a Ward 2 parking sticker would allow individuals to park in Logan Circle, say, which is adjacent to Shaw, taking up spots that Logan Circle residents now need. So if one wants to limit it to a neighborhood, I mean, this is a discussion we've had for 20 years here that never happens, because it becomes very problematic. Parking really, really upsets people. We have a system in place now, albeit not a perfect system, but one that has worked for the 35 years that it's been in place.
Just the second question. Do we have any idea of how many people this affects? How many households does this affect in terms of the folks in Ward that currently live in Ward 6 that have been redistricted to Ward 2? How many people does this involve? And I'm trying to figure out, is this really going to be a big problem? It's not all of Ward 6. It's just that portion that's been redistricted. So does Councilmember Wells, or do you have any idea how many people that will affect? How many cars would that be?
I'm guessing in the Shaw community there are upwards of 7,000 people. So you figure out how many cars do people have. It's a lot.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
For clarification, Mr. Chairman, if I may, it's not a point of order, but a point of clarification. Many of the people that were redistricted and do not have from Ward 2 do not have residential parking. That's like the Gibson Plaza. There's a number of high-rises that do not have RPP. We're to just take the aggregate number of the people that were added in through redistricting does not equate the aggregate number that have RPP. RPP is specific to the neighborhoods that are non-commercial.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Grasso.
Yes, thank you very much. You know, it occurred to me here when I've been thinking about this issue is that there must be a better way to do this than to open up a certain section of the city to park in a larger section of the city like all of Ward 2. And so we did a little digging and we realized that DDOT actually does produce signs that can delineate time for particular zoned parking for more than one type of zone sticker. So they could do that in a section there, for example, where this impact is greater, where these Ward 6ers need to continue to park in their neighborhood that's now a Ward 2 neighborhood, so they become Ward 2 people, and they could actually put signs up. So I have asked DDOT if they'd be willing to do this, and I've gotten no response. But I wonder if maybe the chair of the Committee on Transportation had any luck, and if she might be willing to help us come up to a resolution here that doesn't take legislative action, but can quickly be done where DDOT is assigned to just put up signs to create a particular zone there that allows both Ward 2 and Ward 6 parkers in that neighborhood. Can I ask through you to the chairwoman of the Transportation and Environment Committee if she'd be willing to try to do that with me?
Mr. Chair, I'm certainly happy to raise it with the Department of Transportation.
Thank you. And I have a picture here, if anybody wants to see it, of a sign that says 2-hour parking limit in zone 1 and 4, zone 1 and 4 permit holders accepted, which essentially I'm not sure where this is, but I think it's right on along Georgia Avenue there, which allows people to park in both zones, I think. So
may I respond?
Yeah, and I can respond. Go ahead, Councilor.
Let me respond.
Those are the boundary streets.
The law that we adopted, I believe, 10 years ago in 2001, specifies that I believe it's within one block of a ward boundary.
Right.
The person can get a sticker for like wards 1-2 or wards 3-4.
No, just within they a get block the one of the sticker boundary. And then they're allowed to park in either side of the street essentially or within
Correct.
A block of it. I'm saying why not do the same in a distinct area right there where this is clearly a problem.
There is a bill that Mr. Wells introduced today that's pending in the Transportation Committee. Did you want anybody
no,
else to ask
No, that's not
your
the same thing, Mr. Chairman. That bill would allow the certain people in a particular neighborhood to park anywhere in Ward 2, which Mr. Evans has eloquently spoken against. I'm saying give them the right to park where they live so they don't have to cross over New York Avenue to go there. I believe it's New York Avenue. And by opening it up for Wards 2 and 6 to park in that space, just like you would along a normal boundary space, just make it a larger space.
May I ask
Councilor,
a question?
Bowser.
First of all, Mr. Grasso, I'm not sure exactly where that picture was taken, but we do have that situation usually on the border street.
Right.
That's probably so. Spring Road. We have the same thing in Ward 5 with the border with Ward 4 on Kennedy Street. And it's almost always a struggle every year to make sure DDOT doesn't take down the signs and make sure people don't get tickets. Right. And so it is a back and forth and by no means a perfect situation. But I wanted to understand the emergency because as I understood it, it's not preventing people from parking where they
Chairman,
live.
My time up. I'm sorry, Councilmember Bowser. I didn't know if I can reclaim my time. I didn't think my round was over.
Why don't we do this? Why don't we come back to you in a minute? Let Ms. Bowser.
Well, I just have one more question.
Mr. Grasso.
I just wanted to know if Mr. Wells would be willing to kind of hold back on this emergency for now so that we can try to get an administrative remedy through DDOT to actually come up with a solution here that doesn't require us to do an emergency bill and ultimately create a precedent in the city that could be a bigger problem down the road. And you know, at this point, I'm not willing to necessarily support it simply because I think that Mr. Evans has a strong point when it comes to the entire ward. And that's been demonstrated already in 6 with Ward 7, and I just think there could be a more nuanced, creative solution here if we just put DDOT to the task, and I think that we can make that happen. So would you be willing to withdraw this for now or postpone it for a month and see if we can't get an administrative remedy between now and the, July session and then move it then?
if I could answer, Mr. Grasso.
Mr. Wells?
Actually, I'd reverse it. I don't know what caused it, but DDOT is changing the signs this minute. Maybe they know about the obviously they know about the legislation. I don't know who said you need to get the signs changed immediately, but they're out there changing the signs right now. What I'd rather do is pass the emergency in order to give us, to keep the status quo until we can get a resolution. Because I think that's your intent, is can't we just take a breath? Well, DDOT is out there changing the signs immediately. Of course, they couldn't get the signs changed around the baseball stadium. They said that takes about a month. But somehow they've kicked into gear immediately now that the council is starting to address this.
So don't do a temporary or permanent. Do an emergency for 90 days and see if we can resolve this administratively without moving forward permanently?
Yep.
I'd be okay with that.
You can't.
Councilmember Bowser.
Oh, my God.
Councilmember Bowser.
I guess I don't understand what's going on with what you just said, and they're moving signs, and we have the emergency, or what? I don't understand the action.
Mr. Chair, can I take that as a question?
No. Is it a question?
It's a question. So specifically, Mr. Councilmember Grasso suggested that people who live in the former Ward 2, now Ward 6, can't park in their neighborhood.
Yes, they can.
Well, it's a very narrow area slice that is the new Ward 6 that, you know, was Ward 2. So if there's an event at the convention center, if there's an event, I mean, there's so many churches in that area, it's not like they can spread out. Like if there's those that live next to Eastern Market, when they can't park next to their house, they can go 2, 3, or 4 blocks away and park their car. These folks are now landlocked because they're in this kind of horn that's been dug out to create the this new area of Ward 6.
Okay, so now what your emergency would extend the zone that all of Ward 2 then becomes.
It would say that for the...
And all of Ward 6.
It preserved the status... No, they would not be able to have a Ward 6 sticker. It would just say, for the purposes of parking, you still vote in Ward 6, but your vote does not have to be where you park.
I got it. But then they wouldn't be able to park to the east of where they live. They could park to the west of where they live.
Right. And for the... So their area, they would remain Ward 2 because that's...
Because they're not as, but there wouldn't there be more parking? But my question is, would they not be equally served by expanding to the east to get more parking
spaces?
That's
the convention center.
Okay.
And that's Ward 2. And Mr. Evans kept that as Ward 2. That is now, that is not Ward 6. So they are kind of isolated with just narrow connections to be Ward 6. It's a gerrymandered area in Ward 5. Around that as well.
You moved to 5 and 1.
So what is the Department of Transportation doing right now?
They're changing the signs from Ward 2 to Ward 6.
They're doing what they're supposed to do.
I just got to say they're not doing that.
Oh, so they're doing what you don't want them to do? Or
maybe.
Tommy, are they doing what you don't want them to do,
yes,
or they're doing what you want them to do?
They're doing what I don't want them to do.
I see.
If I can interject, because I'm looking at a map here. For one thing, the status quo is the law that's been in effect for a long time, which is after redistricting, the Department of Transportation is supposed to redesignate the signs depending upon the ward. There actually was, in the committee markup on redistricting, language that would have required no change to RPP, and that was deleted by the council. So the status quo is what the Department of Transportation is doing. I'm looking at a map here, and the map is anywhere from like 4 to 8 blocks in width from one side of the ANC to the other side. And if you think about your own parking habits, people don't like to park more than a block from their house. They certainly don't want to park 4 blocks from their house. And most of this ANC, according to my staff who looked up the RPP records on the Department of Transportation website, most of this ANC is RPP. I'll hold the map up. Everything that's yellow is RPP. So they have zone parking now, which is to say that visitors to the convention center or whatever are time limited in how long they can park on these streets in this ANC. And in any event, that wouldn't change if the designation of the ward were to change. But I just want to clarify that it's not like this is one block in width. It runs from
New Jersey Avenue over to 10th Street to the north, a little bit more constricted to the south, but it's at least four blocks in width. Further on this,
Chairman.
Mr. Evans.
And I do want to point this out. This is the entire Shaw community. When we did redistricting, we made great efforts to keep the community together. We could have divided the Shaw community in half along 7th Street or in half along O Street. But we didn't, because the Shaw community wanted to remain together as a community. And that's what it is. And they can park in their community. If you do this change, residents of the Shaw community will then be able to park in the Logan Circle community or throughout the ward. But it goes completely against everything that we have done in our parking, trying to limit parking to residential neighborhoods. If we do this, there is no reason then you can turn down a request from the Palisades wanting to be part of Ward 2, from Adams Morgan wanting to be part of Ward 2, and every other community that borders on Ward 2 from wanting to be part. Southwest was part of Ward 2, and people in Southwest wanted to keep their Ward 2 parking stickers. So you then lose the entire idea of the program. If, as Councilmember Grasso was talking about, you want to limit parking to neighborhoods, then you do a completely different system. You have 200 different stickers. And if I live in Adams Morgan, I get to park in Adams Morgan, and I can't park in any other neighborhood. But that is a much more complex approach to this parking. What we have now, as I said, is not perfect, but it does work. And so I would really, really ask everyone not to pass an emergency. What I'm concerned about is why it took DDOT so long. Redistricting was done almost 2 years ago. Those signs should have been replaced at least within 6 months. And they were done in other areas. I'm puzzled as to why it took DDOT so long to replace the Ward 2 signs with Ward 6 signs, because they are now issuing and have issued Ward 6 parking stickers to all the residents of Shaw. They have Ward 6 stickers, and they still have Ward 2 signs up. And so that should have been done a long time ago. So I would really ask everyone to not support this, and I would like to move to close debate.
In a motion to close debate, the effect of which is anybody who has spoken will not be able to speak again except the maker of the motion. And the motion to close debate is not debatable. All those in favor of closing debate say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. Is there anybody who's not spoken who wishes to speak? All right, we have the declaration before us. All those in favor of the declaration say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no.
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 The declaration fails. The next item is Board of Ethics and Government Accountability Establishment and Comprehensive Ethics Reform Emergency Declaration Resolution 2014. Councilmember McDuffie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On September 17, 2013, the Council passed the Board of Ethics and Government Accountability Establishment and Comprehensive Ethics Reform Emergency Amendment of 2013. This emergency legislation required advisory neighborhood commissioners to file an annual public financial disclosure certification instead of a confidential financial disclosure with the Board of Ethics and Government Accountability. The Council passed identical temporary legislation, which will expire on July 25th. The Government Operations Committee has noticed a public hearing on a permanent version of the legislation for June 9th and will mark up the bill soon thereafter. This emergency legislation maintains existing law by requiring that advisory neighborhood commissioners file a public financial disclosure certification instead of a full confidential disclosure. The bill additionally requires that candidates for public office file the same public financial disclosure certification as advisory neighborhood commissioners. This change in the law will ensure that unsuccessful candidates of a primary election falling before Baker's May 15th reporting deadline do not have to file the intrusive and burdensome full financial disclosure form. At the same time, the bill maintains the transparency interest in the disclosure process. For background, the certification provides that a public official has filed and paid his or her income and property taxes, diligently safeguard the assets of the taxpayers in the district, reported known illegal activity, including attempted bribes to the appropriate authorities, not accepted any bribes, not directly or indirectly received government funds through illegal or improper means, not raised or received funds in violation of federal or district law, and not received or been given any anything of value, including the gift, favor, service, loan gratuity, discount, hospitality, political contribution, or promise of future employment, based on an understanding that the public official's official actions or judgment or vote would be influenced. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. McDuffie. We have the declaration before us. Discussion?
Chairman.
Mr.
Grant. May I just have a brief statement as to why this has to be passed on emergency?
Through you to Mr. McDuffie? Mm-hmm. I mean, through me to Mr. McDuffie. Mr. McDuffie?
As I stated in the statement, Mr. Graham, there's a we scheduled a date for a permanent bill, but the temporary is scheduled to expire on July 25th.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have the declaration before us. All those in favor of the declaration say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. On the underlying bill, Mr. McDuffie?
So moved.
Discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. We'll turn now to emergencies at the request of the mayor. If this could be distributed, please. All right, this is being moved by me. The legislation would approve the transfer of jurisdiction. What's before us is transfer of jurisdiction over 0.92 acres of land in lot 802 in square 4325 within Fort Lincoln Newtown Emergency Declaration Resolution of 2014. This legislation would approve the transfer of jurisdiction of 0.92 acres of real property owned by the National Park Service and under the jurisdiction of the district within the Fort Lincoln Newtown development to the Department of Housing and Urban Development. In the mid-1970s, Fort Lincoln Newtown Corporation was selected by the federal government to develop 360 acres known as the Fort Lincoln Urban Renewal Area into Fort Lincoln Newtown, a mixed-use development project. The area is bordered by Bladensburg Road northeast, South Dakota Avenue northeast, New York Avenue northeast, and the District Maryland border. The development to date at Fort Lincoln Newtown has included over 1,700 housing units and 140,000 square foot distribution facility and Costco. In order for three additional residential development projects to proceed, approval of this resolution is required for development to occur on the 0.92 acre parcel. Both ownership and jurisdiction of the parcel must be united and the land transferred to HUD. HUD will then package the parcel with approximately 1.6 acres of abutting HUD urban renewal land so that the combined parcel can, via the district, be transferred to the Fort Lincoln Newtown Corporation for development. The transfer of jurisdiction from the district to HUD is necessary for NPS, the National Park Service, to in turn transfer title to HUD. The transfer of title from NPS to HUD is on the agenda for the National Capital Planning Commission's June 5th, 2014 meeting, necessitating approval of PR 20-754 today on an emergency basis. I suspect that that's a little bit confusing. All the members are familiar with Fort Lincoln Newtown, and actually the boundaries include New York Avenue, which I guess I did read in the description. The parcel that's at issue here borders Eastern Avenue and borders Bladensburg Road. It's a small strip of land, less than an acre. It cannot be developed without it being united with the rest of the land. It was thought that all of this land was, that the title was unified. In fact, the title is not unified. So what this is about is enabling unifying the title, first by our transferring jurisdiction, which is not title, back to HUD. HUD will then, back to National Park Service. National Park Service, in turn, will transfer to HUD. HUD will then unify the title, and then transfer to Fort Lincoln Newtown, which is a limited liability corporation, which will then proceed to develop it. Uh, If this could be circulated, please. This is a fiscal impact statement from the Chief Financial Officer. Can this be distributed, please? There's more confusion and more documents around this than is necessary. What I've just distributed is a fiscal impact statement from our budget director. What is now being distributed is a fiscal impact statement from the Chief Financial Officer. Attached to the fiscal impact statement from the budget officer is apparently a copy of the bill that's incomplete. The complete bill, which was introduced at the request of the mayor, was in the folders that all the members received. What we are voting on is the bill as introduced, subject, of course, to technical corrections by the General Counsel's office. And the fiscal impact statement by our budget director does include a statement that the CFO must confirm that this transfer of jurisdiction is in line with Internal Revenue Service requirements. And as far as I know, the fiscal impact statement from the CFO does that. So all the paperwork is complete between the red folder and what's been handed out and what's been additionally handed out. Is there discussion on the declaration?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilmember Bowser.
I'm looking at the CFO's fiscal impact statement, but I don't see what it says. Funds are sufficient, but it doesn't say what the impact is. Is it just this one sheet?
I actually gave away all my copies of the fiscal impact statement. And what is your question, Councilmember Bowser?
My question is, what is the fiscal impact?
There is none.
Okay. But it says funds are sufficient.
Yes, that's because that's their standard language.
Okay.
I don't believe there's any fiscal impact to this. The property has been maintained by the National Park Service, according to the hearing that the Committee of the Whole held last week. And so we've expended no money, even though we've had jurisdiction over the property. With the transfer of jurisdiction, we'll no longer be required to spend any money on the parcel. But there will be economic development that comes out of this transfer. There's no further discussion. I move the declaration. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have unanimously. I move the underlying, which is PR 20-754. Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. The next item on the agenda is option period 4 of task order number DCTO-2010-T-0100 with Sprint Communications Company LP, approval and payment authorization emergency declaration resolution of 2014, PR 20-752. Councilmember McDuffie.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Today, on behalf of the mayor, I'm moving the option period 4 contract number DCT0-2010-T-0100. This contract was a multi-year contract with Sprint Communications Company LP for wireless telecommunications products and services and other products and support services related to enterprise communications and information technology. The services were contracted for a base year and for 4 option years. The council approved the original contract package on August 16, 2010, approved the option year 1 on July 8, 2011, and approved option year 2 on April 8, 2012, and option year 3 on March 26, 2013. Option period 4 has a not-to-exceed amount of $2,024,410.83 for a term from April 7, 2014 through April 6, 2015. Approval is necessary to continue to provide district agencies with wireless telecommunications products and services and other products and support services related to enterprise communications and information technology. I move the declaration, Mr. Chairman.
The measure has been moved. Is there discussion? All those in favor of the declaration, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? The ayes have it unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, please record me as voting present.
Mr. Grasso will be recorded as present. On the underlying bill, Bill 20-782, Council Member McDuffie.
So move.
Discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Mr. Chairman, please record me as voting present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grasso will be recorded as present. The next item is modification to contract number DCHBX-2013-0003A, approval and payment authorization emergency declaration resolution of 2014, PR 20-746. Councilmember Alexander.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Today I'm moving the networking for future contract at the request of the mayor. The purpose of this contract is to allow the contractor networking for future to provide technical support in the operation and maintenance of the HealthLink system in order to support the requirements of the Affordable Care Act. An emergency indefinite delivery, indefinite quantity, IDIQ solicitation was issued on April 29th of 2013 to several CBEs, and an award was granted to Networking for Future. The Healthcare Exchange entered into a contract with the Networking for Future to provide technical IT support in the amount not to exceed $811,000 from April 30, 2013 through April 29, 2014, with the one-year option periods. The contract subsequently has been increased to not exceed the amount of $1,538,000. The increase in cost is due to the increase in personnel and the hours required to man the project. The initial estimate was made prior to the implementation of the program and the determination of the level of support that would be needed to effectively run the DC HealthLink system. So it's necessary to approve this contract because it's now greater than $1 million, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
We have the declaration before us. Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grasso will be recorded as present. On the underlying bill, Bill 20-779, Councilmember Alexander.
So moved, Mr. Chair.
Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grasso will be recorded as present. The next item is Board of Directors of Washington, Washington Metropolitan Area Transit Authority, alternate member Matthew T. Brown, appointment emergency declaration resolution of 2014, PR 20-761. The mayor submitted on May 2nd the resolution seeking to appoint DDOT Acting Director Brown to the WMATA Board of Directors as an alternate member. Director Brown would replace Terry Bellamy, who, as the prior DDOT director, served in this role. The Committee of the Whole held a hearing on Director Brown's nomination on Thursday, May 29th. The committee received no testimony or comments in opposition to the nomination. Mr. Brown's appointment to the board ensures that the district maintains its full complement of board members at WMATA. Just for members' clarification, all of the members of the WMATA Board of Directors are technically appointed by the council, and as a matter of courtesy, two of them are nominated by the mayor, and this is one of the mayor's nominees, but the appointment is actually ours, and because it's a council appointment, the Committee of the Whole held a hearing on it. I move the declaration, which is PR 20-761. Discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilmember Che.
Mr. Brown, the nominee, is currently, as you mentioned, the acting director of DDOT, and I wanted to say that since he's assumed that role, my staff and I have found him to be an excellent choice. He's very competent, very capable, and not only is he the head of DDOT, but he's also particularly qualified for this role since he used to be the head of WMATA's Office of Management and Budget, and therefore he knows the agency quite well, a skill that will be very beneficial for him and for us as he serves as the district's representative on the board. And I hope we can support this emergency because I want him to go to work right away. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Che. One of the questions we asked at the hearing was about his use of Metro, and he testified that he's a frequent rider. Further discussion? On PR 20-761, the declaration, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. I move the underlying, which is PR 20-762, to appoint Matthew Brown. All discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. The next item is modification numbers 10 and 10A to contract DCKA-2011-C-0026. Approval and payment authorization emergency declaration resolution of 2014, PR 20-799. Councilmember Che.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. DDOT has a contract with Park Mobile that allows drivers to pay for metered on-street parking by phone. The program, as many of you know, has been enormously successful. This legislation approves option year 3 for that contract in the amount of $4.5 million. The district exercised partial options on April 7, 2014 and May 16, 2014. And so I'd like to move this now to continue the option year 3 of the contract. So move.
The declaration is before us. Discussion? All those in favor of the declaration say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grass will be recorded as present.
Thank you.
On the underlying bill, which is Bill 20-806, Councilmember Che.
I move the bill, Mr. Chairman.
Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grass will be recorded as present. The next item is contract number DCKA-2009-C-0123. Modification numbers 12 and 13, approval and payment authorization emergency declaration resolution of 2014. Councilmember Che.
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. This legislation would approve modifications number 12 and 13 to DDOT's contract with the C&D Tree Services, Inc. Company for tree removal services. On February 4th, DDOT partially executed option year 4, which had the effect of raising the total value of the contract to just over $1 million. The $1 million threshold. And so we need the emergency now to keep the contract in effect. So I move the emergency.
Thank you, Councilmember Che. Is there discussion on the declaration? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Present.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grass will be recorded as present. On the underlying emergency act, Councilmember Che.
I move the bill.
Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have
present,
it unanimously.
Please.
The ayes have it unanimously. Mr. Grasso is recorded as present. We'll turn now to temporary legislation. There's one item before us, which is Heatwave Safety Temporary Amendment Act of 2014. Councilmember Che.
I move the bill.
Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it unanimously. I don't believe there's any other business before us. We had previously discussed what our schedule will be. I expect there will be an additional legislative meeting following the Committee of the Whole on June 17th. And members agreed that our July meeting will be not July 8th, but Monday, July 14th. The time is now 2:50, and this meeting is adjourned.